Welcome to the Pacific Research Institute's Next Round podcast. I'm Rowena Ichon, Senior Vice President, and with me is Tim Anaya, Senior Director of Communications.
Hi, Ro. How are you?
Fine, thanks, Tim. Were you wearing your mask all weekend?
No, I stayed at home all weekend. It was more the question you should ask, did I move from my couch watching the Olympics all weekend? And the answer to that was mostly no, including I stayed up till 2 a.m. on Saturday into Sunday to watch the Olympic Golf Championship.
Oh, well, you know, I watched that in the morning. See, I did a little experiment last night and I had recorded it. I had YouTube TV, so it's all kind of on demand. And I managed to watch about 3 to 4 hours of Olympic coverage in about 20 minutes, because they've got so many commercials and so much blather about, you know, this and that and recaps and so on and so forth. So I recommend that if you just want to watch the actual competition, you can get it all in just half an hour, I bet.
Yeah, I do that in the evening. They have, this is the best stuff that people want to watch. So I tape that. And then usually there's other stuff going on at the same time. So I will flip between the two. And when the live coverage goes to a commercial, then I flip back and zap through, you know, all the other stuff, because I think it's a 4 hour primetime show every night. I probably watch less than an hour of it because there's so much other stuff that's just blather or sports that I don't care about.
Viewership is way down, but I still love it. I like seeing the athletes. I like watching the drama and the individual stories of the athletes and all of their trials growing up. And so I think it's still very inspiring. I love to see the American flag waved around when, you know, we win gold or silver or bronze. I think it's still a great thing.
Agreed.
So here we are 18 months later, still talking about COVID. And now there are these new studies, one in Massachusetts, in this province town, and another one in Israel, showing that if you, even if you have been vaccinated, you can still get it and spread it. But the great news is that the vaccine still prevents serious illness and death. And the problem is that the White House and the CDC keep flipping around in their message. And I can see why it has people's heads spinning. And you would think, Tim, that they would have a good public affairs person, people like us. I know when I was young, you know, as a young press spokesperson, you know, in a crisis mode, you have one voice. That's, you know, that's PR 101. I'm just wondering why no one's done this yet at the White House.
And don't be mistaken, we're not volunteering to
no,
be the one voice. I mean, there's so much of PR 101 that they have thrown out the window here. I think it's really trying to pass the buck. When there's good news, we'll wave the flag and we take credit and look at the wonderful things we do. And now that there's mainly bad news, well, the CDC did it. Let them do it. You see it even with this debate this weekend over the eviction moratorium expiring right at the federal level. Now, I think it's ridiculous that we've had it this long. You know, people are back to work, or we're paying them so much money to make more money staying at home than going to work. Can't they afford the rent? But this whole battle this week of, they didn't even ask until the day Congress adjourned to pass the extension. Now, you can debate the merits of the proposal, but now you see Speaker Pelosi trying to say, well, the CDC can extend the mandate. Well, I don't think that the CDC should be setting policy about eviction moratoriums. You know, that's something that Congress should be doing, but it's all that kind of passing the buck. When something bad happens or where there's some bad news to deliver, they're going to have these punt to these, even though they're government entities, they're kind of third party entities that aren't necessarily on message.
Well, Tim, I think it's also odd that what's left out in the conversation is that a lot of states have stepped up to the plate, like California. And I think it's more of a state and local issue about these eviction policies and so forth. So I don't even know why the federal government is getting into this act.
The biggest thing is, you know, you're right. The overall issue of messaging, people don't know what to do. You know, there's been so many changes just in California alone. Who knows when you're supposed to wear a mask, where to wear a mask? Do you wear it while you're by yourself? Do you wear it with other people? If you have one person, what if you're both vaccinated? I mean, you just can't follow it. There have been so many kind of stops and starts and turns back and forward. And it's no wonder people don't know what to do on the vaccine, because it seems like the answer changes every day.
Right. Well, you know, I'm sure we will still be talking about this in next week's podcast. But what I was excited about, Tim, is that we got this All-Stars podcast organized to watch the recall debate, the challengers to Governor Newsom's recall effort. And you just emailed me this morning and told me that Larry Elder is dropping out. What a bummer.
Apparently, he says that he has a prior commitment, which is to do a fundraiser in Bakersfield for the controversial former state Senate minority leader, Shannon Grove. But the answer that he gave was he doesn't think that Republican candidates should participate in a circular firing squad against one another, as that will only help Governor Newsom. And he said that, you know, really any of the other Republicans that are running, he's fine with them. I get the strategy, but, you know, if you want to be the governor of California, you got to show up. You know, what was the big thing that we remember the 2003 recall? That one debate that was organized by the California Broadcast Association, Arnold went to that debate and he kind of pumped it up, no pun intended, to this is the Olympics of debates. And you kind of got to be on that stage to pass the smell test of for voters that you're a serious contender. And so it'll be interesting to see what reaction, what effect his not debating will have on his campaign. But I would argue, you know, firing squad or not, kind of got to show up on the debate stage to kind of pass that smell test to be the next governor.
I totally agree with you. Last poll shows that he was 18. He had 18% support, much more than the other two candidates, Falconer of San Diego, former mayor of San Diego, and John Cox, businessman who ran in the last gubernatorial election. So I think that by him missing on the podium, the race also generates less, to me, enthusiasm. And I think that's what Republicans need. They need, as we know, a big turnout. And so I think you've got to get people rallied and understand the issues and so forth. So I would have liked to see him debate. And I also would have liked to see Caitlyn Jenner.
Well, and the Republicans really need to rally around one candidate to have a shot to beat Governor Newsom, because we don't know, as the polling has shown, something like over 40% of the voters are undecided about how they're going to vote in the replace election. And that's mainly Democrats and independents. Now, not all of them will vote, but some of them will. So I would argue that among these Republican candidates, they really need to coalesce behind the person with the best shot to win, or else you could have an unknown Democrat get the most votes just because they have Democrat next to their name. So, and I think going to a debate like this, you know, Larry Elder, who has a vastly superior communication skills to any of the candidates, he could have blown the other candidates away and really
wiped the floor. I totally agree with that.
Yeah, he would have wiped the floor and could have begun to consolidate as the Republican alternative to Governor Newsom, much like Arnold did at that debate in 2003. Once Arnold showed up and showed he had what it took to be governor, his support took off.
Well, in any case, I hope our listeners stay tuned to our next podcast, where we will have our all-stars who will be watching the debate closely. So we will tell you all about it. So in this podcast, our guest is Melanie Kirkpatrick, author and former deputy editor of The Wall Street Journal. She's currently a fellow at the Hudson Institute. Well, so her new book, and I thought it was fantastic. I read it over the 4th of July weekend. Her new book is called Lady Editor, and it's a biography of Sarah Josepha Hale, a remarkable woman in American history who we really ought to know her as a household name. She was the editor of the most prominent ladies' magazine in her day, publishing authors like Edgar Allan Poe and Harriet Beecher Stowe, responsible for bringing the wedding dress to America and even Thanksgiving Day. Not to mention, she penned a nursery rhyme that's super famous. Everybody knows it, but I'm not going to be a spoiler here. So you'd all listen to the podcast. Sarah Hale, she's kind of like a Anna Wintour, Martha Stewart, and Claire Booth Luce all rolled into one. So I think you'll enjoy the interview. And if you're looking for summer reading, check out Melanie Kirkpatrick's book, Lady Editor. Thanks for listening. Welcome to PRI's Next Round, Melanie.
It's great to be with you, Ro.
So when I read the opening of your new book, Lady Editor, the biography of Sarah Josepha Hale, I was so amazed by the accomplishments of this great woman that I wondered why I never heard of her before. Why wasn't she a household name? So how did you come to learn of Sarah Josepha Hale and write her story?
Well, thank you for the question, Ro. I love to talk about how I discovered her. She was a household name in the 19th century. And I say in the book, I think she was the most influential woman of the century and one of the most influential women in American history. Everybody knew her name. There was a book, for example, of a cookbook that she wrote, and it was called Mrs. Hale's New Cookbook, I believe. And you didn't have to say who she was because everybody knew her name. I learned about her when I wrote a history of the American holiday of Thanksgiving. And I learned about her because Sarah Hale is known as the godmother of Thanksgiving. It was she who persuaded Lincoln to issue a Thanksgiving proclamation calling for a national day of Thanksgiving in 1863. She had been writing to presidents for two decades before Lincoln did this. And she also had been campaigning for a national day of Thanksgiving in her magazine, Godey's Ladies Book, which was the most popular magazine of the pre-Civil War period. Before Lincoln's designation of a national day of Thanksgiving, individual states would call a Thanksgiving or maybe not. Some of them didn't have Thanksgivings in some years. So Sarah Hale was the one who launched this national day of Thanksgiving that we all enjoy today.
So as we read in your book, you know, Sarah Josepha Hale had so many accomplishments. You just mentioned, you know, that she was a very successful editor of a ladies' magazine in her day. So can you tell us a little bit about her role publishing some of the major writers and poets in American history and her influence on American culture?
Sarah Hale was had a great eye for talent. And when she became the editor of Ladies Magazine in 1828, and then she went on to become editor of Godey's Ladies Book and build it into a national publication. When she became editor in 1828, she had the idea of publishing articles by Americans on American topics and fiction with American settings. This would seem obvious to us today that American readers would want to read about their own country. But back in the 1820s, there weren't publications that offered that kind of writing. Instead, they would clip a British newspapers and republish them without credit. She was also a great talent spotter. And so she published some of the great names of American literature, Nathaniel Hawthorne, Edgar Allan Poe, and many others. So she would publish them in her magazine, their poetry, their short stories, and she would also write about them and introduce them to the public. This was also true for female writers who are not so well known today, but she helped create the careers of many women writers of the day. such as Lydia Sigourney, and I would add Harriet Beecher Stowe, who is one author that we all know. She was a very patriotic woman, the daughter of a man who had fought in the Revolution, and she was born just before Washington was inaugurated. And she also thought the publishing American literature would help create a common culture and helped to bring the American people together.
So Sarah Josepha Hale was also a tireless leader in her efforts to promote education for women. What was the educational level of women during her time? And actually, while she championed women's education in the pages of her magazine, she also used her influence to open and fund women's colleges and to promote teaching as a profession for women. So could you talk about Hale's efforts in promoting widespread education for girls and women?
Every issue of every year of her magazine talked about education for women. She was passionate on the subject and, as you say, tireless. She believed that women were the intellectual equals of men. This was not an accepted idea, to say the least, back in the 1820s and 30s and on. But she argued that women were capable of doing any job that men do, so long as it wasn't based on their physical strength. She did say men were stronger than women. But she said they could do that as long as they were educated. So she promoted first education for girls, and at a time when only about half of American women were literate. And more than that, she was a great proponent of higher education for women. She herself was homeschooled by her mother and then by a brother who went to Dartmouth and would come home at vacations and teach her everything he had learned at Dartmouth. But there was not a single college in America that accepted women. And her passion was to create institutes of higher education. So, for example, in the early 1830s, she supported the founding of Mount Holyoke College. And then carrying on to as late as the 1860s, she was very involved with the founding of Vassar College, which was, in her mind, the most academically rigorous college for women in America. She also supported co-education, and many colleges were formed during the period of her editorship that were co-educational. And one other thing that I think is very interesting and that will surprise many people today, she was a proponent of women being teachers. In the early part of the 19th century, women were not considered smart enough to be teachers, other than teachers of very small children. Hale said women, if they were educated, could be teachers of any age group. She also thought women were better teachers than men, because of their inherent compassionate nature. By the 1840s, the American attitude about women as teachers had radically changed, and there were many, many teachers in the public schools, and it was considered by the middle of the century really a women's profession.
So other traditions that we take for granted today, like Christmas trees and white wedding dresses, were also due to Sarah Josepha Hale's influence. So tell us about this and other traditions that we owe to Hale.
Cody's Ladies Book was, as I said earlier, the most popular national magazine in the pre-Civil War era. And part of its popularity was because it also included information, articles that would appeal to the growing middle class in America. And for example, Sarah Hale was the first to introduce a recipes section in a publication in America. There were sections of her magazine on, for example, health and beauty and other topics that might appeal specifically to women. The Christmas tree and the white wedding dress are examples of just how influential she was. She published a drawing from a London newspaper of Queen Victoria and her family gathered round a Christmas tree. And once she did that, the passion for Christmas trees among ordinary people took off. And very soon after publication of that picture, many American households had Christmas trees every December. Similarly, the white wedding dress. Sarah Hale was a big fan of Queen Victoria, whom she saw as a moral leader. And when Queen Victoria Maria was married, she wore white. This was unusual. Back then, women wore all kinds of colors, but not necessarily white. So Sarah Hale wrote about that. Then she published articles and etchings of wedding gowns. And the fashion caught on, and Americans were soon wearing wedding gowns, and it was considered a symbol of virtue and purity, and it became very commonplace. Another fashion, so to speak, that she encouraged was dancing the polka. She loved to dance, and when the polka was introduced to America by immigrants from Germany and Central Europe, she would write about it. She even had an article describing how to do it, an illustrated article, step by step, and she was part of the reason that polka dancing became popular in the middle of the 19th century.
So Melanie, you talk about her having fashion in the magazine, but she didn't really care for fashion, but she realized that it's something that American women wanted to read. So I thought there was some kind of marketing genius behind this. You also mentioned that in your book that Sarah actually tried to market the magazine to the men, the head of households. Talk about her kind of great business sense.
Oh, Sarah Hale, I wouldn't say she had a good business sense, but she was practical. When she moved to Godey's Ladies' Book, which was owned by Mr. Godey, she recognized that she was going to have to accept fashion as a part of the magazine. She hated fashion, as you mentioned. She thought it was an expression of vanity and was often not worth the money that women wasted on it. Another reason she disliked it is that most of the fashions and certainly the trends came from Europe. Once again, she wanted to see an indigenous American sense of fashion. And she described that as something that was simple and modest and not very costly. So, but Mr. Godey recognized that fashion sold magazines. And so she went along with it. But in her inaugural editorial, the opening article for when she became editor of Godey's Ladies' Book, she went on and on about how terrible fashion was. So she staked out her ground. She was going to let the pictures in her magazine, but she sure didn't like it. Sarah Hale was very shrewd, and as I mentioned earlier, practical. In the first issue of Ladies Magazine, that was the first magazine she edited starting in 1828, she appealed to men to subscribe to the magazine for the women in their households, their wives, their daughters, their sisters, their mothers. And this was clever because they had the purchasing power to order the magazine, whereas women at the time could not control their own funds. The only women who had property rights were married women, widowed women, excuse me. The only women who had property rights were widows. And all other women, almost all other women, there were occasional exceptions, their financial affairs were managed by their husbands or their fathers, or in some cases, their brothers. A married woman had to relinquish all of her rights to her husband. So that meant that when Sarah Hale, a widow, became editor of Ladies Magazine, she was the one who could negotiate with writers and business people because she was a widow and had the authority to do that. She wore black. She wore mourning for the rest of her life. 57 years dressing in nothing but a black dress. I can hardly imagine. Part of the reason for that was that it made a statement to the world that she had the authority to act for herself.
Another thing that I found interesting was that Sarah Josepha Hale was responsible for penning the children's rhyme, "Mary Had a Little Lamb." Can you tell us the backstory of this poem?
This is a wonderful story, Tim. Whoever thought that Mary Had a Little Lamb was written by Sarah Josepha Hale? You know, I always thought Mother Goose wrote it. But she wrote it. Yes, she was a children's writer. Among her more than 100 publications outside of the magazines were many books for children. And in 1830, she wrote this 3-stanza poem called Mary's Lamb. It was published in a book called Poems for Our Children, in which she collected a number of the poems she had written. And it had her name on the cover. Then the next year, Lowell Mason, who's known as the father of singing in schools, created a melody for Mary Had a Little Lamb and published it in a book of a songbook for schools. It was one of the first school songbooks published. And he didn't credit her. A couple of years later, the McGuffey Readers published Mary Had a Little Lamb as Lesson 47, again, without crediting her. McGuffey Readers were, as you can guess, were books about how to teach, books of teaching reading. And they were popular from the 1830s until World War II. So many Americans were exposed to Mary Had a Little Lamb, but without knowing that she was the author. After her death, there was quite a kerfuffle about that, and no less a personage than Henry Ford got involved in trying to prove that somebody else was the true author of the publication. But no, it was Sarah Hale, and I hope she gets the credit she deserves one of these days, and maybe my book will help a little bit.
I wonder if it's a new Elvis kind of phenomenon. Has anyone seen Sarah Hale and Mother Goose in the same place at the same time?
Oh, I love that idea.
So turning to a more serious issue, so Hale was for the abolition of slavery, but she didn't care too much for the Civil War, and her magazine largely stayed away from politics. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Mrs. Hale thought that slavery was morally wrong, and she vigorously opposed it. At the same time, she thought that we had to live with the founders' compromise and that slavery would eventually be abolished, but we shouldn't go to war over it. She said the preservation of the Union was the number one priority. She believed, and this is hard to understand in the context of the 21st century, but she promoted something called colonization, that is the sending emancipated slaves to Africa, specifically the country of Liberia, which was created by American freed slaves as a home for them. She thought that freed slaves would have a terrifically hard time in white America as independent actors, and that they would face such discrimination and prejudice that it would become impossible for them to succeed and be happy. She even wrote a novel about this, whereby a slave owner wishing to free his slaves tried out different places in America. They tried to consider where they might be successful, and he went to different places in America, and in every case, the freed slaves were unhappy. And finally, at the end of the book, he sends them to Liberia. She didn't consider the practical matter here. It would be impossible to transport so many freed slaves to Africa. But more than that, she didn't really consider the moral issue, I think. Or if she did it, she looked at it from a different point of view. The issue about it, America was the country of the slaves too, not just of the whites. And so this was a difficult issue, but it was not an uncommon idea in that period of time. Mr. Godey, the owner of Ladies Godey's book, did not want any mention of politics in his magazines. When it came to the Godey's Ladies book, about half of the circulation or a third to the half of the circulation was in the South. And I speculate that he did not want to offend his Southern readers. So Hale could not write about politics, or specifically slavery, the issue of slavery, in Godey's Ladies book. She did write about politics when it came to some women's issues, such as creating teachers' colleges for women using government funds, or other issues regarding education and civil rights of women as well. She was a very active proponent of repealing laws in individual states that limited the property rights of women.
Interestingly, kind of along these lines, while she was definitely a woman ahead of her time, it was interesting to read that she didn't believe women should get the right to vote. So can you tell us about this and why you think that a woman who had so many advanced ideas didn't think that women should be able to vote?
Mrs. Hale was really a woman of the 18th century. And while her ideas about education for women, ideas about women working and being in the public eye were radical for her day, I don't think she simply was able to take the next step to suffrage. And she believed that politics was a dirty business. And of course, the period of the 20s and the 30s and the 40s was a very fractious time for American politics. There was fighting in the halls of Congress, for example, and she just thought it was a dirty business and that women should stay out of it. She saw women as a higher moral force. She thought that women were above politics and that their job instead was to remind their husbands and the other men in their lives of their moral duties. But she didn't want to, when it came to politics, but she didn't want to get down into the into the mud and have women do the political wrangles about how to settle some of these contentious issues. She lived to be 90. And I like to think that if she lived to be 100, she might have changed her mind on that. And toward the end of her life, she did endorse the idea of women running for seats on school boards and voting for the school boards. So that was a baby step toward the issue. And oh, I might add, Sue, it's very important for me to mention that she was not alone in this view. The majority of American women at the time opposed women getting the vote.
So Melanie, you also write that Sarah Hale was the leading cultural arbiter of her day. Women turned to her for advice on what to read, what to wear, how to behave. So fast forward to today, what do you think Sarah Josepha Hale would say about American women? Do you think she'd be proud or shocked?
Oh, Ro, that's a challenging question. I think a little bit of both. The one area in which I think she would be tremendously disappointed is having to do with the dignity of women who choose to work in the home. She was adamant about trying to elevate the status of wives and mothers. And she believed that taking care of a home and a family was the most satisfying, the highest duty that a woman with children had. So she published many articles and books about how housekeeping was a profession. And she coined the term domestic science, again, trying to make national respect for women working at home higher. So I think she might take a look around America today and wonder just how far Americans have come when it comes to valuing women who choose to stay at home. That's one thing. And another thing is related. I think that she might have been disappointed that so many women who are in the working world, in her view, perhaps don't pay as much attention to their families as she thinks they should. But other than that, I think she would be astounded and happy and proud that women have made so many leaps forward. She, for example, take women doctors, which she promoted. She wanted women to be, not men, only women, to treat other women and children. Of course, that's not possible, but that was her ideal. She wanted to see women out in the workplace when it came to the medical profession, but she thought they should exclusively treat women and children. Today, more than half of women, of the medical students are women, and we're reaching a point where there are going to be, before long, more female doctors than men doctors. And I think she would be ecstatic about that change.
So, Melanie, as we close, Mrs. Hale, as you document in your book, had so many great accomplishments, and we certainly laud her for those. But there's one area where we disagree with her, and that's temperance. So here at PRI, we love nothing more on our Next Round podcast than to talk public policy while enjoying a great glass of wine with our proximity to all the wonderful wineries in wine country. So we always ask every podcast guest this question: what beer or wine or cocktail or otherwise beverage are you enjoying to celebrate the publication of your book, or recommend that readers enjoy while reading your great book?
Well, I'll say that Sarah Hale was involved in an early stage in the temperance movement, but she also published recipes for beer and for wine, though she, of course, didn't see them as beverages that you could abuse, I think. As for what am I drinking? Well, the answer is actually an easy one. It's Veuve Clicquot Champagne. Veuve in French means widow. And the widow Clicquot, like Sarah Hale, was a contemporary of Sarah Hale. And when her husband died in the early 19th century, she took over his business and built it into an international sensation. So she was a widow for 61 years. Hale was a widow for 57 years. So I think that the two would have liked each other. And I like to think of the two of them sitting together, both dressed in black and enjoying a glass of Veuve Clicquot champagne.
Melanie, I did not know that. That's fantastic. Great recommendation. And thank you so much for doing this podcast.
Thank you. I enjoy being with both of you.
If you like this episode, please tell your friends and subscribe to PRI's podcast at iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, TuneIn, iHeartRadio, and Spotify. And when you're on these platforms, don't forget to give us a big 5 stars. If you don't subscribe to any of these, you can still listen on PRI's YouTube page, youtube.com/PacificResearch1. That's the number 1. Thanks for listening. I'm Rowena Itchon. Hope you'll come back again for Next Round with PRI.